So I hope now you are seeing the slide, and we will start where we stopped in the last class. We were discussing interpretive communities, and why we were discussing interpretive communities, a term that was given by Stanley Fish, because we are discussing text, context, and discourse. So when we talk about text, context, and discourse, Stanley Fish's very popular statement in the form of a question, "Is there a text in this class?" comes into play. And a very popular anecdote is also associated with this statement, "Is there a text in this class?" And we know that once a student in the opening of a semester came to Stanley Fish and asked this question, "Is there a text in this class?" To which Fish understood that a student was asking about a reading material. But then the student repeated again, no, "Is there a text in this class?" Then Stanley Fish realized that the student is not asking about reading material, but student is asking about whether there is a theoretical viewpoint through which the text we are dealing with, the books that we are dealing with, we will study. So theoretical viewpoint or theoretical viewpoint, like a Marxist viewpoint, feminist viewpoint, structuralist viewpoint, post-structuralist viewpoint. So there are various theoretical viewpoints that are there, and the student was concerned about that particular theoretical viewpoint and not a particular text that is to be used in the coming class. So what is the essence of this Stanley Fish episode? Is there a text in this class? That a linguistic utterance is open to many interpretations, and a text is to be interpreted in a knowable context. So knowable context is a guideline or is like a map through which you can show that, okay, this is the route you need to follow if you want to reach there and reach where, reach to a valid interpretation. So context or situation is a guideline. So we know that if we want to do something, there can be more than one guideline. So similarly, if we want to interpret a text, there can be more than one interpretations, but more than one is not equal to all. More than one can be 2, 3, 4, 10, 100, but it is not all. So we should not fall into the trap that many interpretations is equal to all, because all interpretations are not valid, but many interpretations are. And how we will realize that which interpretations are valid and which are not? We have some interpretive communities. Now, this is a term, this is a terminology. This is particularly a phrase given by Stanley Fish, that it is the work of interpretive communities to ascertain, to determine which interpretation is valid and which is not. Because when we talk about interpretation, we are talking about how a particular thing is qualifying for meaningfulness. So all the things that are there in this world. They cannot be associated, with particular text. If we take the example, colorless green ideas sleep furiously, given by Noam Chomsky in 1957 in the book Syntactic Structures. And if someone says colorless green ideas sleep furiously, so there is a color green, and that color is also greenless. That is the property of that particular color. But your commonsensical knowledge tells you that there is no such property, that something that is colorful and at the same time something that is also colorless. You know that these two things are quite contradictory. Similarly, if someone says, no, ideas also sleep as human beings, so again, you won't find these type of arguments convincing. So this is how, and not only you, many people like you, many readers like you, they also find this idea that something that is colorful is also colorless, absurd. Many readers, they will also find that ideas, they cannot sleep, and they will also agree that even something or someone sleeps, then cannot be furiously. So this adverb is again not adding any meaning to the verb sleep. So this is how one interpretive community is built, and many interpretive communities are built. For example, sun rises in the east. Now this statement is also based on the interpretation of some interpretive communities, because all of us who are uttering this sentence that the sun rises in the east, they are living in this planet Earth. Now there is a possibility that someone who is on another planet, and there is a possibility that for that particular person who is living on that particular planet, sun is rising from the west. But again, that is again a hypothetical situation, that there are other planets where there is a life, and there are other planets where people are living. And even if there is a possibility like this, and we are in contact with those people. So that means if someone says living on this earth that sun rises from the west, then you will say, like, what type of statement is this? So this is how any interpretive community is built. Interpretive community is built because there is a context, and that context is a knowable context. And when we talk about a knowable context, that means that context is already there in the mind of the reader, in the mind of the speaker. So not one speaker, it is something shared. So this context is something, a shared knowledge that all of us have. And because of this shared knowledge, we are in the position to analyze a text. Now there is another fine distinction you can make, how a text is different from a discourse. You find a text that is something written, or something that is spoken, that is your text. But when it comes to discourse, then discourse is something, unwritten regulations that are there. Unwritten regulations, they are responsible for exerting the meaning of a particular text. So there are so many situations that are there, and it is nowhere written that this particular sentence you will utter or you will write in this situation. This one-to-one matching is nowhere recorded. So in the dictionary, what you find? In the dictionary, you find a word, its usage, its pronunciation, its grammatical category, and there are other meanings associated with that particular word, other grammatical categories in which that particular word is used, and how you can use that word in real life situations. But again, certain situations are mentioned, for example, but all the situations that are associated with particular text cannot be written down. That is unwritten regulation, something that is unwritten regulation, that is very much inherent, very much central, a part of a discourse. So this is another understanding of a discourse that you need to take into account. And this is why a text is something that is written, and not only written, but it is written or spoken following some regulations. And what are those regulations? Regulations related to the grammar of that particular language, the phonology, morphology, and syntax of that particular language. But when it comes to discourse, everything is agreed among speakers, but it is unwritten. It is unwritten regulation that we have. This is also a way through which you can have an understanding of what is text and how text is different from discourse. So you can see the heading that I have written on this slide: text, context, discourse. So on one extreme, left hand side, you have text. On right hand side, you have discourse, and in between there is a context. That means, what is the bridge between text and discourse? Context is working like a bridge, and this context is actually binding these two extremes. At one point you have text, and at another point you have discourse, and in between you have a context. So this is also an understanding that you need to keep. Now coming back to interpretive community, because the word interpretive is associated with communities, we are concerned about that particular community that is producing meanings. So there is one linguistic utterance, and how we produce more meanings, how we can associate more meanings with that particular utterance. This is basically the work of interpretive communities. And interpretive communities, all are speakers of at least one language. So we are also a part of interpretive community. At the same time, we are readers. So in that way, we are also the part of interpretive communities. So as a speaker of a language, you are part of a larger interpretive communities. But as a student of English literature, you are a part of smaller interpretive communities. But still, it is interpretive communities that are there. Now, we have seen that it is not only Stanley Fish who states that meanings are already conditioned by situation in which it was uttered. It was previously said by Wittgenstein in Philosophical Investigation. And at the same time, we have a term, this indeterminacy of signifiers. And what is the meaning of indeterminacy? That is how we are unable to fix the meaning of a signifier. Let's say skeleton. A skeleton is a signifier. Now, when I ask what is skeleton, then already you have an understanding of the word skeleton. But when I say skeleton in the cupboard, now this skeleton skeleton in the cupboard, this is not the same skeleton as I said previously in isolation, the word skeleton. So here I am not talking about the anatomy or the anatomical object of human being, but here when I say skeleton in the cupboard, that means I am talking about something that is a secret, and that secret is somewhere hiding. In that sense, here the meaning of skeleton in the cupboard means. So this is indeterminacy. This is indeterminacy that we have, and this indeterminacy is associated with not only one signifiers, but almost the entire language is metaphorical. And when the language is metaphorical, then this indeterminacy is prevalent. This indeterminacy is there throughout the language use that you have. So this is also a point that we need to keep in mind. At the same time, when Stanley Fish says that a contextual setting and the sign of its presence is precisely the absence of any reference to it. That means this first part, a contextual setting and the sign of its presence. That means we are talking about a situation. We are talking about a situation that is already there in the mind of all speakers. And therefore, it is precisely absence. And therefore it is precisely remain absent, and we do not give any reference to it. So we talk again using this metaphorical language, and we know that we are using this metaphorical language, but at the same time we know that a contextual setting and the sign of its presence is already there in the mind. That's why we do not give any concrete reference to each statement that we use. So coming to context, that we discussed that when the question arises that where do we find a text, and the answer is that we find a text in context. So we find text in context. That means this context is working like a bowl that we have, and in that bowl we have this text. So this, what is the nature of a bowl? The nature of a bowl is like something inside that bowl that is there, and the bowl is covering that entire thing, protecting that entire thing. That is the nature of a bowl that we have. So similarly, we have a text, and the text is there in the context, because the context that is there, this context precedes any sentence or any utterance. And as we have already discussed, that knowable context transforms a text into discourse. So when it comes to context, then we will fall back to context in which we are accustomed to hear such utterances. So it is again a similar situation. If I ask you to think about a bird, and you think of sparrow, you think of crow, you think of parrot, you think of pigeon, but you are not thinking emu, you are not thinking penguin, you are not thinking ostrich. So this is because you are accustomed to associate a particular text into the most possible knowable context. So there is a possibility that other knowable contexts are also available, because penguin also qualifies that penguin is a bird. Ostrich is also a bird. Emu is also a bird. But kiwi is also a bird. But when I say think of a bird, you say crow, pigeon, sparrow. Fine. Or in some European country, they will say robin. Now, this is how. So we move for more knowable context to the less knowable context. So once there is something said, there is a sentence, our mind works with the more knowable context. We try to find out the meaning of that particular text in more knowable context. So the point is that how we able to understand a text, or how we are in a position to associate many meanings with a particular text. Because when it comes to understanding, we have a good understanding of situational competence. We have the situational competence. We know that how a particular text is uttered and where, in which situation that particular text is uttered. And if the particular text is uttering in these different situations, then what are the different meanings that are associated with that particular text. So these are the things that are also associated with text, context, and discourse. So linguistic competence is not enough, because linguistic competence is making you competent in the grammar of that particular language, but situational competence is making you to make an utterance or write a sentence in different situations, in different contexts as well. So situational competence is a broad thing, and when it comes to linguistic competence, it is a narrow thing, because linguistic competence is associated with phonology, morphology, syntax. But when it comes to situational competence, then it is also the pragmatics, how a particular language or text is used in the society. That is a broad thing that is again associated with this. So again, here we have this demonstration that lingual or linguistic competence is narrow, but situational competence is broad. So what does it mean? It means that the words that we have in the dictionary, they themselves do not determine the meaning, but rather the context. Because words that are there, their meaning is there, but that meaning in the dictionary is not the one final meaning or the one final sentence that you can utter, because you know that many sentences that you utter that are not there in the dictionary. But because you have a rich knowledge of situational competence, that's why you can use the same words in different contexts, and you can associate more meaningfulness with those words. But at the same time, we find that there are certain writers like Derrida, like Bloom, or even Fish. And when we read something that is out of the blue interpretation, what is out of the blue interpretation? There is a poem by William Black, "A Tiger, Tiger Burning Bright in the Forest in the Night." Now, "Tiger, Tiger Burning Bright." Now, this tiger is what? And if one interpretation, like out of the blue interpretation, is let's say someone, a hunter, let's say killed a tiger and consumed the meat of that particular tiger, and now the stomach is burning. So tiger, tiger burning bright. So this is out of the blue interpretation. So now the question arises that we are both situational competent and linguistically competent, and we can make this type of interpretation as well, that tiger, tiger, tiger burning bright is let's say the meat and the because someone has consumed the meat of the tiger, and because of that the person's stomach is burning. So what is, whether this type of interpretation is valid or not? So this is out of the blue interpretation. But the other question we are raising that the text of Derrida, the text written by Bloom or Fish, why that particular text becomes so difficult for us, because it is not a text written by any other. So many people, they find like it is too difficult to understand Derrida. So generally they go for the paraphrasing. They won't go for the original text. Similar case with Bloom. So what is the reason for this type of problem that we have? But we say like the whatever the Derrida is saying, that interpretation is valid. Whatever Bloom is saying, that interpretation is valid. So what is this? What is this thing happening here? Literary critic M.H. Abrams, he says that an utterance or a text, one meaning that is associated is literal or normative meaning. But there are certain interpreters like Derrida, Bloom or Fish, they are known as stubborn interpreters. So stubborn interpreters, like it is a metaphor for them, and that they are stubborn. So in what sense they are stubborn? That means they are imposing their own meanings. They are imposing their own meanings to that particular text. So when we read that particular text, we do not get the literal or normative meaning, but the meaning is something different. The meaning is something altogether different. So this is like an imposition. They are imposing their meaning, what they want to say, on the same text. It is not easy to impose your own meaning, because if I say that tiger burning bright is a dietary problem, then obviously and if I stick to this, then obviously it is not like I stick to it and I am stubborn, then all the people will believe it. That means like they are stubborn, they are imposing their own meanings, but all at the same time they also have this ability, this capacity to convince the interpretive communities that okay, this meaning is also very serious, this meaning is also very, very much valid. So they are stubborn. At the same time, they are also producing valid interpretation and different interpretation. So it's not like they are forcing us on a gunpoint that okay, this you need to believe. We are reading it, we are buying their books, and because their argument is so much strong, that we start believing okay, this type of meaning, this thing can be read with these meanings as well. So this is another point that is associated with text, context, discourse and interpretation. Now, how to do text analysis? That this we will study in the next class. So I stop here. But before that, I would like to know if you have any problem.